today's video, let us switch to signaling networks from gene regulatory networks and overview some of the basic concepts of what is a signaling network and how one tries to go about building these interactions and, you know, reconstruct the signaling network itself. So, welcome back. Let us look at signaling networks. So, what is a signaling network? What is signal transduction? So, it is usually signaling involves the sensing of something happening outside the cell, some extracellular thing leading to some intracellular response. This is what signaling normally is. So, there is some signal which is essentially some information. It could be the presence of light, it could be the presence of a nutrient, it could be some presence of a danger if you are looking at larger organisms, which represents information essentially, which is detected by specific receptors within the cell. There are certain receptors within the cell, on the cell, and this is converted to an intracellular response, which invariably involves a chemical process. This chemical process could involve changes in metabolism, in regulation, in motility, in gene expression, in so many different things, right. But the key ingredient is that something outside the cell is causing something inside the cell, right. So, this conversion of some sort of information, extracellular information, which is transduced inside the cell to produce an intracellular response is called signal transduction. So, a lot of extracellular signals work by complex cascade systems that have the effect of amplification, as I was mentioning earlier. If you have a long chain of interactions which finally lead to an amplified signal. You may have one photon that is incident on your eye, which produces 10 to the 5 proteins or 10 to the 5 of some other metabolites which respond to that one photon, right. So, this allows basically for a small number of extracellular signaling molecules to influence the function of a very large signaling pathway or a very large set of proteins within a cell to finally culminate in the desired physiological response, which might be motility, you know, moving chemotaxis, moving towards the presence of some glucose, right. Or it could be the change in gene expression, right, turning off something. I no longer see lactose, I am turning off my lactose machinery, things like that. So, this is a schematic for a signaling pathway. So, how does it look? So, you have an extracellular stimulus which is sensed. You need a sensor protein to first sense it, a receptor, which produces a signal which is then transduced. There is a regulator, there are multiple operons that may be involved, a network of interacting proteins may be involved, finally giving a response. Is this good enough? You need also some feedback. Why? You do not want the response to keep firing, right. So, what happens when you sense a danger? Maybe you see a snake, your adrenaline starts pumping, you know, you maybe start taking up more oxygen because you want to create some energy to, you know, run or whatever, but you just want to but maybe once you just do not want it to keep firing, right. Or for example, when you walk out of a dark room into a brightly lit room, right, your eye starts, something happens. Your pupil starts contracting, but it has to stop, right. It has to adapt. It should not be firing, because the response is you have to reach a new steady state, right. So, this is called desensitization of the signal. You become desensitized to the perturbing initial signal. This is a very important aspect of signal transduction, right. So, what do you have? An extracellular signal molecule, a receptor protein, usually outside the cell, which may have an internal domain as you see here, then a bunch of internal signaling proteins, finally controlling either a metabolic enzyme or a gene regulatory protein or something cytoskeletal, which will involve motility and so on. This is a classic canonical representation of any signaling pathway in any cell typically. So, what do we mean by a signaling network? So, this whole thing is a signaling network, right. You do not have just this, you have a bunch of proteins here, then a bunch of downstream things, and you may have several allied signaling proteins, right. So, you may also typically you integrate the two signals, right. So, there is some independent pathway, we have a lot of crosstalk.
this would have this would independently take a particular route, this would independently take another route, but when the two are present you may have a lot of crosstalk between the signaling pathways. Maybe this protein can also bind the protein here and so on. So, you basically have a complex network of interactions whenever there is signaling. So, let us look at signaling and metabolism, right. We did do a little bit of metabolic networks earlier on, we will again do some more metabolism today, but both signaling and metabolism involve production or degradation of substances. In one case it is small molecules, in the other case it is some, it could be small molecules again in signaling, but often it is larger molecules or proteins themselves which are turned off and turned on. They may not be degraded, but they may be just switched off. And then lots of molecular modifications. You know, here it is in signaling it is mostly phosphorylation, methylation and acetylation. In metabolism you have many more complex types of modification. You could have activation and inhibition of various reactions. Same thing that holds for signaling as well. What are the differences? In metabolism you have a lot of mass transfer, in signaling it is mostly information processing and transfer. So, in metabolism the network is determined by the current present set of enzymes catalyzing the reactions, whereas in signaling there are compounds of different types and there is a lot of complexity that is possible. You can have subnetworks, modules, all operating in different ways. You do have pathways here, but here in signaling the organization is a lot more important, because one module might fire under one condition, the other module might fire under another condition, so on and so forth. And in metabolism you have lots of reaction happening, right. You have nanomolar, micromolar, millimolar level concentrations, whereas in signaling we are talking about a few molecules. You are not talking about a few moles or micromoles, you are talking about a few molecules. Right. So, still in many cases you have enough molecules so that you can go in for a regular dynamic modeling, but some cases you may have to resort to stochastic modeling. So, how do you reconstruct signal networks? What does it mean by reconstructing a signaling network? First question is, what are the proteins that are involved and what other components participate? So, any signaling network has, what are the components of any signaling network? You have a receptor or sensor, whatever, where a signal comes and binds. Then you have intracellular domain typically, but then you have a bunch of intracellular signaling proteins and what are known as second messengers. This could be something like and so on. Small molecules that usually carry some information from one protein to another and so on till finally your downstream proteins. This whole thing is your network, right, starting from this protein if you will all the way up to these proteins. So, how does it look like? And the next thing you need to worry about are, what are the ligand receptor interactions? You may have CAMP which is a ligand which will go and bind to some receptor, right. Or what are the receptor intracellular component interactions? What are the intracellular component interactions? And finally, you know, maybe DNA is involved, right. You have a transcription factor that is prevented from binding somewhere, or made to bind, a repressor is made to bind to the DNA, one of these things. So, this is how it looks like. So, you have nodes, then modules organized into pathways which basically translate the signaling inputs to some signaling outputs. And you can have different types of reconstruction. You can have a just simple connectivity based reconstruction. What does this mean? This means that there is an edge in the adjacency matrix, but you do not know the sign of the edge. You may know the sign, in which case you get more information like this. You have IKK inhibits IK beta, which then inhibits this NF kappa beta switching on and off. So, this is more detailed than what you have here, right. So, it depends upon the level at which you have data, it depends upon what is the question you want to ask of the signaling network, typical things. So, if you know that you are dealing with very small number of molecules, you will have to start worrying about noise. So, stochastic modeling is you do not no longer talk about concentrations and things like that, but you instead start talking about probabilities and numbers. How many enzymes are in phosphorylated state, right? And yeah, expected number of molecules in a particular state. What is the probability of a particular event happening, right? So, usually assume that if there is x of this, there will be 0.1 x of something else. No, with some probability you will have the number of molecules which will be in state B will be drawn from a distribution. It is not deterministic. So, if you run the have a simulation, you run it many times, you will get different outputs. Another way to go about this reconstruction is something known as a stoichiometric reconstruction. You basically treat all these as chemical reactions, right. You have one IKK plus one molecule of this protein plus two molecules of ATP giving, you know, some other phosphorylated version of this intermediate or something like that. And then you have this reaction which finally gives you two ADP, right. You have chemical modifications happening all along. We will see how the stoichiometric matrix is built couple of slides down the line. But basically you start modeling them as reactions instead of networks, right. So, this is finally going to represent a network, but this is notionally different in the sense you are looking at individual signaling reactions rather than a network.
So, in today's video we looked at some of the basic concepts underlying signaling networks and how one goes about reconstructing signaling networks. In the next video we will move over to metabolic networks, which has a special emphasis in this course. And we will look at some basic concepts of metabolic networks. How does one reconstruct metabolic networks and what are the different ways to represent metabolic networks?